So hi, I'm Emily Domanico. I'm at Penn State doing a master's. And there I'm studying cartography, urban transportation, and infrastructure with a particular emphasis in how maps are used to facilitate and maintain these spaces. So today I'm going to be talking about an ongoing master's thesis project in which I'm studying map use in transit control centers. So to start, when we say cartography and transit in the same sentence, I'm sure all of our minds go to something like this, a transit map designed for passengers to help them navigate through the system. Notably, my work doesn't directly look at this. I look at a different type of schematic diagram that goes on behind the scenes. So I'm looking at map use in the rail transit control center, and here teams of dispatchers monitor the traffic, the safe movement of both people and trains throughout the system, and the state of the rail. So instead of using a qualitative color difference to go for different rail lines here, color is used to represent the state of the track, and it gets more complicated, but broadly, red is occupied by a train, green is routed, white is available for routing, but there's a lot more that's going on there too. And briefly as to why this is an interesting thing to study now, it should be no surprise in the history of rail. There's been a lot of technological improvements in just how we think about where something is and how we're able to represent it. But even going back more historically than just the past 10 years, there's an interesting move to centralize rail control and dispatching operations. So on your left, there's a tower operation center, and these towers are dispersed out in the field. And this is from a photo from Providence, Rhode Island in the 40s. And on the right, we have a photo from Seattle's Sound Transit, their link operations here. And there's a movement to go from these very geographically dispersed centers where you could presumably look out a window and see the train to get everything remotely sensed and consolidated to one location. And to do that, you have to bring in many visuals, a lot of different information infrastructures are coming together here. So I'm focusing on a couple of different questions here. They boil down to how is location information represented in the control center? What's the role of the map in this process? Then how are those maps used in context? Thinking about how they cater to different situations that arise, and then more broadly, how does the design of those maps meet their practice in everyday use? But that's a little bit of a bigger question that I'm still working on. And part of the motivation for this project was to think about maps used in everyday practice and not necessarily just as the cartographic output with a north arrow, scale bar, and that kind of thing, but thinking about maps as a performance of space, as a diagram that's used regularly, and to complement some of the work done in more cognitive science and psychology disciplines, looking at basically how people are perceiving these blocks that are moving across a diagram, and to work not in simulation, but to work in a messy everyday context here. So to structure a more qualitative study, I'm using archival work, fieldwork, and survey work, which I'll talk briefly about. And I've been developing an archive of rail dispatching technology that's both contemporary and historical. I have information for about 11 different control centers throughout North America. Currently, it includes photographs, verbal descriptions of rail dispatching technology and the control center environment more broadly. And what I find kind of fun is it ranges from very formal and very, you know, polished publications to everything from just a transit nerd's account of this tour that he got at the control center. And putting that all together has been very fun. So along the more formal aspect, there's job descriptions, operating procedures, patents, but then also press material and personal tours from blogs, which has been fun. Looking more historically, there's an interesting pattern of rail signal interaction that comes out that dispatchers aren't necessarily thinking about, but there's this body of knowledge and practice sort of embodied in the tools they're using that goes from back the start of rail from like the 1850s to 1900s, where you had large switches that you would throw, and it was a very physical action, which is terminology still used in the control center today. You'll throw a switch and set that. Part of that is because there's still some switches out there that you do physically throw. Others are more operated by the computer today. But moving through that, there was a development of interlocking machines where you have these levers, cranks, and pulleys. I like the one on the top right here because it reminds me of like stacks in libraries where you're turning things around, all the way to button pushing operations. So to route a train, you'd go and push it from one end to the other, and that would set the signals for that path of travel. And today we have cursor navigation. So dispatchers have a zoomable system map, and they can go in and click to set switch paths of travel. And then that is reflected on a large overhead public display. And then these notably all newly renovated control centers, which it's much easier to find visuals and stuff about when they've been renovated. They all feature these large backlit video walls, which go by many different names, from overheads to mimic boards. Depending on the age of the person talking to you, they have a different term for what they call it. And these displays are all designed to cater to decision making at a glance. So they display states of the system that are continually updating. They're dynamic, but they're meant to cater to a glance up or looking from a working on something and looking over, checking where something is. So there's a pace to them that's not super continuous. There's a couple different reasons for that. And this is just in here to say, this is Grand Central's control room. So this is where they control Metro North and traffic going in and out of part of Grand Central Station. It was recently updated. The picture on the left, I believe, is from 2006, and then 2013 on the other side. And that's not to say that everywhere is being updated. This is an image from 2014 in the New York City MTA. And this is one of those tower operation centers. And we see the old interlocking machine and this model board up there with lights that indicate movement. So to get to how people are thinking about movement in this context, watch the diagram here. This is all done with block-based signaling, and part of that is inherited from just historic infrastructure of dispatchers only generally know whether a train is present or not in a stretch of track. So whether it's tripped an individual switch and moves on, the length of signal blocks varies widely throughout the network and also from one network to another. So the sense of speed is really done in a mental map that these dispatchers are monitoring throughout. They have to know how fast a train should be going through this network. And I'm happy to talk more about that later. But putting together a lot of these visualizations, there's a couple trends in symbolization, notably the color that I mentioned before. Red and green seem to be consistent as to rail car present or not, or green being routed. There's differences in what orange, pink, and blue mean from place to place, which I find is very interesting. Direction indicators usually come down to an arrow, but how that's done varies a little bit. So in Boston's MBTA, they have it integrated into the track itself, which is interesting. There's an interesting kind of pattern with whether a river is represented or not. If the rail goes over a river, it tends to make it on the map with this little block. But if the rail's going alongside a river, which there's like concern for flooding still, but the river's not on the map at all, which I think is interesting. And then headway clocks. So representation of time throughout the system is generally pretty standard. People think in this digital clock ticking, ticking up or ticking down. And things that are not making it into this interface, how long a train is stationary for. It kind of just sits there, and that's part of this present or not present movement visualization. The number of passengers on board is just information not collected by many transit authorities, because they don't have the infrastructure for it. That's slowly changing. The length of the train, which this is something that I find interesting with air traffic control. They don't do much with altitude visually. And in rail dispatching, they don't do much with the length of the train, which you think would be important. The speed that the train is traveling, like I mentioned, the signal blocks are not regular. They change, they vary widely in length. So any idea of speed is coming through with just this sense of how fast or where something should be at a given time. The idea of a base map is interesting because they don't think in base maps. They just sort of have this idea that they know the network, and that's what they need. And then the location within a single block isn't dealt with. So additionally, going through kind of fast here, I spent some time on the floor of a dispatching center at SEPTA, where I was able to interview and talk to dispatchers. And they had some interesting quotes. There's a large sense of that all these visuals are redundant. They have to be able to do this all without anything there to support them. So I could do all this work without the maps, but I don't want to. And then they had some interesting things with Reflex. So I'm in the process of the iterative process of coding with all this. But there's an introduction of more geographic maps and geographic representations of the system with continuous animation. That's adding another level of location information on top of what's already there. So there's a movement towards more heterogeneous and overlapping location information coming in, which I think is an interesting moment of engagement for the dispatchers. They're presented with all of these problems that they get to solve, and they're having more tools to solve them in different ways. And that's, instead of a point of confusion, potentially a point of engagement. And as for what's next, briefly, I'm using all of that to fine-tune a survey that's going to go out to multiple dispatchers, and something like this. But yeah. Briefly, acknowledgments, the cartography specialty group gave me their master thesis grant, which makes a lot of the observation or fieldwork more doable, which is great. And if you want any citations for anything, a lot of them were cluttering the slides, so I sort of pulled them back, but I have them if anybody's interested. And thanks.
We've got time for a question, if anyone has a question for Emily. If not, then let's give her another thanks. Oh, we do have one, sorry.
Do they have like a computer program that acts like a simulator, like a flight simulator, or is it just on the job?
A lot of it is on the job, at least for what I've talked to dispatchers at SEPTA about. They have a class that they take. It's about an 8-month class, and then they have, for the regional rail part, they sit at every desk along the network, so the territory is broken up to 6 desks, and they have on-the-job training with somebody next to them for about 2 to 3 months before they move on to doing it by themselves. Some other more well-funded places might have simulators, but I haven't found access to them.
Any other questions for Emily?
So you had mentioned that some of the dispatchers have commented that they don't really use the map or it's not necessary. Mm-hmm. Is your sense that because maybe the maps they're using aren't that great, they could be better?
Yeah, I think that there's a lot that they think about on a day-to-day basis that just isn't supported by the map. And what I found really interesting about observing is that you could see the failure of the map, but you don't necessarily want to say that it's failing because it's what they're using, like it's their thing. But there's opportunities there to integrate just different ways of communicating, both about the map within the control center environment and without information out in the field. A lot of this goes down on radio communication because that meets more of the situational nature, but that is pretty divorced from this visual itself. So I think it's an interesting dynamic.